Esperasas. My name is Lucy Loizou and welcome to this week's Family Law Show brought to you by the International Family Law Group. I am a family law solicitor at the International Family Law Group and I specialise in financial matters and cases concerning children. Some of you may know me from my work on London Greek Radio. I have a fortnightly radio show where we take calls from listeners in relation to family law. I also write for the Barigiagi newspaper and also for various other internet sites on the web that on family law topics. My firm covers all types of family law. We offer services to clients both nationally and internationally, and we're there to help couples who are in difficult situations. Today's programme is going to be focused on the rights concerning unmarried couples and their children and what happens in the event of a relationship breakdown. Over the forthcoming weeks, we're going to be covering a number of other topics to include divorce, finances on divorce, cases concerning children, if you want to relocate to another country and move abroad with your child, what you need to bear in mind. We'll have a programme dedicated to the alternative ways of dealing with disputes without having to go to court, as well as a number of other topics. So back to today's programme. I'm joined in the studio by my colleague, Stuart Clark. Stuart is a solicitor at the International Family Law Group and is regarded as one of the country's leading family law solicitors. He specialises in cases concerning finances and children, and Stuart often undertakes advocacy at court where he represents clients. Stuart, welcome to the studio.
Thank you, Lucy. Hi.
So the format of our programme today is that I'm going to be asking Stuart a number of questions relating to the rights of unmarried couples and their children, and Stuart's going to be providing us with some general tips and guidance for our viewers. So first of all, Stuart, just looking at unmarried couples, is there such a thing as a common law marriage, and what does that mean?
Well, Lucy, this is often where unmarried couples fall into difficulty. There is no such state in law as the common law marriage or a common law husband and wife. This is a myth that has grown up, unfortunately, throughout the years. In some jurisdictions, I'm aware that after a certain amount of years, couples who aren't married do have certain rights with regard to the other person's property, but that's not the case here in England.
And so if, let's say, you've had a couple that's lived together for 20 years or so, this concept of common law man and wife just doesn't exist if they haven't actually got married.
No, sadly, it can be quite sad in that situation where if for some reason people have decided not to get married and have lived together for, as you say, 20 or so years, there's no right to from one party to the other for any property division upon separation or ongoing maintenance. This changes if children are involved, and I'll come to that later. But in the usual scenario where there have been an unmarried couple who, after 10, 20 years, they split up, there's simply no redress under the law. This myth of a common law marriage and rights to the other person's property, it doesn't exist,
apply.
Sadly.
And if you're unmarried and you split up, are you automatically entitled to a share of your partner's assets on separation?
No, as I say, there's no real right to any property division or ongoing maintenance. There are certain orders, which I'll come on to a bit later, about what can happen with a property if you've purchased a property together or have contributed towards a property. But as of right, and unless a right in a property can be established by other means, there's no automatic right upon separation to any property division, ongoing maintenance or other orders which would otherwise, if the parties had been married, be available. So you could have the case where you've been together for 20 years and you've actually got less rights to property division than a couple who have been married for say 5 years.
So the length of the relationship doesn't really make a difference.
Yeah.
And so say, you know, people get together, they buy property together. What should couples be thinking about if they're looking at buying a property?
Well, the first thing I would always say, and solicitor would say this, is to take legal advice. Often not at the forefront of your mind in the first flushes when you're moving in with someone, but looking ahead and what can happen on a relationship breakdown, it's always quite important to take legal advice as to how to best record how you're purchasing a property together. one way in which you can do this, and a common way of doing this, is to record it by way of a deed or any written instrument, really, which just records what the intentions are when you're purchasing a property together, who's contributing what money to it, and how you intend to deal with the property should the relationship unfortunately break down. Another thing which you might consider, and which often particularly childless couples do not consider, is to draw up a will together, which sets out what the other party will get should the party unfortunately die. And those sorts of things, as I say, not usually at the forefront of people's mind when they get together. It's sure. It's all in the first flushes, but it's something you really should consider when purchasing a property and as an unmarried couple.
It just seems as though there's quite a few things to consider, and as you say, important to take that advice before, you know, before you buy a property.
Well, yes, it's the issues of prenuptial agreements in this country is something which I won't develop here and will be a matter for elsewhere. But when getting together as an unmarried couple, it's a similar sort of thing should sure. be considered, really, just to set out your rights and who owns the property and what you intend to do with it when you. Should you, sorry, unfortunately, the end relationship end.
Mm. And couples will often look to buy a property jointly, potentially. Mm-hmm. What does that mean exactly? Are there different types of joint ownership? Should couples be aware of this?
Well, fortunately, it's more common now for conveyancing solicitors when a couple are purchasing a property to advise as to how the property should be held together. You may be aware there are two types of ways in which property can be held. First is a joint tenancy. Under a joint tenancy, should one of the co-owners of the property die, their share of the property will transfer automatically to the other party who they co-own the property with. That's irrespective of anything they've provided for in their will. Conversely, as tenants in common, should one party die, the property would actually go to their next of kin under a will or under the usual intestacy rules. Those sort of things should be considered when purchasing a property, and often a conveyancing solicitor will advise both parties to a purchase as to the types of ways in which they can hold the property. Whichever way they do, the presumption would be that the property is held jointly and held on a 50-50 basis unless there is another document, like I referred to, a deed or something similar, which sets out their joint intentions as to ownership and percentage ownership.
Mm. And what I would say to our viewers is that if the plan is that one of you is going to put in more than the other, but you still intend to buy a property jointly, the deed that Stuart is talking about is so important, because that is the document that's going to differentiate who gets what in the event that the relationship breaks down. So really important that you get one of those drawn up. It's very different to a piece of paper that you both sign around the kitchen table saying this is who's going to get what. It is a legal document, and it's something that you should seek advice on. So looking at the situation then, where we're commonly faced with, couples come in and they say to us, unfortunately relationship has broken down and they're separating, what happens with property then?
Well, in the case of an unmarried couple, you can look back onto the deed or any such instrument which we've referred to and see if there is that document which exists, and that will govern what will happen when they separate. As we've said, it's important to have that document, as sure. on that unfortunate event of the parties separating, that document will govern what will happen. If people own the property jointly, there will be a presumption that they should have 50-50 share of the proceeds of the property if it's to be sold, or one person could buy the other party out. That would be the presumption in the usual case, unless an alternative intention can be shown. If the parties don't own the property together, which is often the case, someone will simply move into the property owned by their partner. There are still remedies available to the non-owner, so to speak, who during the course of the parties being together has contributed to the property in terms of financial, towards the mortgage or towards sort of utilities or other upkeep of the property. Again, this will come down to what the joint intentions of the parties are. If there's a record of it, or if there's some sort of joint accounting, which often happens in households, it may evidence some form of intention that the parties intended to own this jointly, and may also set out in what share that property was meant to be owned.
Mm. I mean, I think the one thing I would also just add to that is if you've got a case where the property isn't owned jointly and it's in the sole name of one party only, if you've got, let's say, you know, the lady who usually is a mum as well, there's children of a relationship. If she is simply contributing as a homemaker, which we are coming to, and she doesn't pay the mortgage, she doesn't pay the bills, etc., anything like, you know, if it's purely homemaker, that is not going to give you an automatic right in order to claim against a property that's in the other person's sole name. In order for you to establish a claim, as Stuart says, there needs to be joint intentions. Paying the utility bills alone is not going to establish that. It needs to be more than that, and that's why the law in this area, it really is quite harsh in relation to unmarried couples. So just moving on to our next question, Stuart, do these aspects need to be agreed by people, and how does it work?
No, as I say, if there is not this clear document at which sets out, and often there isn't this clear document which sets out, I intend this, I intend us to hold the property together as 50-50 or 75-25, the court can look at the behaviour of the parties, look at other evidence, emails, correspondence, joint accountancy as home people in a home often undertake, and impute an intention. Find that the parties must have intended this to be the case upon them separating. It's a harder case to make out before the court, for certain. If that's why we have urged to have this document at the outset of living with someone, but absent that agreement, it's not the end of the road, and it's something which you should take advice on, as it's hard to pick out examples of what can evidence that. But if that is the case, certainly see a solicitor, and it may not be the end of the road for you for establishing an interest in the property.
And just going back to this point we touched on about contributions, mm-hmm. and the distinction between the homemaker and the person who contributes financially, how does it work with unmarried couples then?
Well, as you say, if the stay-at-home party does not contribute financially to, say, the mortgage or utilities or anything like that, then it really does not count as a contribution, so to speak, for the purposes of distribution of property for unmarried couples. Unlike, say, in a marriage where the homemaker and the person who goes out and earns money is respected equally, it's not such the case in the case of unmarried couples. It really is a financial contribution to the property itself in some way. Even as you say, the homemaker bringing up the children, this is not a contribution for these purposes, and as you said, it can lead to some quite harsh outcomes and people finding themselves without an interest in the property.
One thing we would say to our viewers before we just touch on how things work with children and unmarried couples is that this area of law is one that is under review. There have been various consultations over the years. There aren't any immediate plans to change the rights in relation to unmarried couples, but it is certainly something that is being lobbied in Parliament regularly, because there is such a stark difference between the rights that you have as an unmarried person and the rights that you have as someone who's married. So take early advice, legal advice. So moving on to the position with children, there are a number of couples in this country, across the world, who aren't married and they have children. What happens with children? Do children have rights? Are they protected? What can a parent do if they're not married?
Well, as I said earlier, for unmarried couples, there's the routes that I've already spoken about for establishing property claims, but there's no ongoing maintenance, unlike for married couples. That when a married couple divorce after a marriage, then there can be orders made for one party to maintain the other. This isn't available to unmarried couples, but the rights change when children are involved, and they're for unmarried couples who do end their relationship. An application can be made for the resident parent under what's called Schedule 1 of the Children Act 1989. These are for financial provision for the child of a relationship.
And so talk to us then, what does the Schedule 1 claim involve, and is it usually made by unmarried parents?
It's usually in the sphere of unmarried parents, or almost exclusively so. It's a claim for financial support by the resident parent against the non-resident parent, and I will use that term, those terms when discussing this. Is resident parent, as it says, is the person who the child lives with most of the time. Non-resident parent is the person the child doesn't live with most of the time. The resident parent can make an application under Schedule 1 of the Children Act for financial provision for the benefit of the child. In order to do so, there must, you've spoken about international families bringing applications, there must be some link between the couple and the child to the UK. It can either be the child is here with the resident parent, or that the child and resident parent are abroad and the non-resident parent is here. In certain circumstances, both could apply. So really, the resident parent has these rights as an unmarried parent to bring an application for financial provision to assist with the upbringing of the child.
And how do the courts decide these types of applications?
Well, it's a long, complex list of case law which comes out of these applications, but a few underpinning principles have arisen. Understandably so, the income resources of both of the parties are taken into account, even capital resources available to the child, him or herself, is taken into account, and understandably so. The needs of the child and how the child is to be brought up is taken into account. You're going to speak in other programmes about children proceedings in which the welfare of the children is paramount. This is not the case in Schedule 1 applications, but the courts have found that it is still a constant influence on how these cases are decided. The focus really is on the needs of the child, and not the need of the resident parents, the needs of the child and how that child is to be supported financially. Another aspect of the decision, how the courts deal with these matters, is they'll look at the standard of living of the parents, especially if the parents have cohabited beforehand and the child has lived with both parents. The standard of living enjoyed by the child with both parents should continue once the relationship ends, is how the courts address it. And if the parties have not lived together in any event, if one parent is the more wealthy of the two, that will influence how the resident parent brings up the child. The courts will look at it that a child will say, "Daddy has all this wealth and has this big house," and try to, in effect, match that up for the mother, who's if she's the resident parent.
Mm. And what claims can a mother, usually it's a mother, it may be a father, what claims can a mother make?
Well, as I just mentioned, the first thing is housing. To avoid a disparity between the resident parent and the non-resident parent home, the court can make orders that there be a housing allowance or that the non-resident parents contribute to the housing needs of the resident parent and the child. Often it will come down to what can be afforded out of the non-resident parent's capital and income position. But really, it's to try to afford a house for the child and resident parent to be housed in. Another way in which the courts will assist the resident parents from the non-resident parents is by way of ongoing maintenance. I spoke earlier that unmarried couples do not have to pay maintenance to each other once the relationship ends. This is not the case where there is a child. It does correspond with child support agency payments, which I'll come to later, but in the main, under Schedule 1 of the Children Act, maintenance can be ordered for the benefit of the child. Another way in which the non-resident parent can be ordered to support the resident parent is by way of a lump sum payment. This is separate to a maintenance payment and separate to a housing allowance. It's for these one-off payments that come with bringing up a child: furniture, cars, those sort of things, and reimbursement of expenses of the resident parent in bringing up the child. Those are the main real heads of what can be paid. And in addition to maintenance, the carer, the resident parent, can be given what's called a carer's allowance. That's an allowance to go with all the expenditure that goes with bringing up a child.
Mm. And you talked about housing and possibly getting a house for mum and child to live in, or dad and child to live in. Can you keep that property outright?
It's not usually the case that the resident parent will have that house going forward into the future, past the child reaching 18 or the end of tertiary education. It's really the purposes of these applications is to provide for the child, him or herself, not the parent. So what the court usually orders is that there be a house provided for the resident parent and the child up until the child reaching 18, and then the house will revert back to the non-resident parent who has funded it, or a proportion of the payment to the house goes back to the non-resident parent, depending on the situation. They're very fact specific, but in the main, the house does not get kept by the resident parent past the child reaching 18. In terms of the lump sum payments that I've mentioned, those do not have to be repaid to the non-resident parent. The purposes of them are to buy items during the child's childhood, and so they don't need to be paid back.
And one other thing just to say in respect of lump sums is that you can apply to the court for more than one lump sum in the child's minority, so up to the age of 18. So it's not just one lump sum. You can, however, only make one claim in respect of property. So, you know, keep that in mind at all times. Some of the other things that can happen in Schedule 1 claims is that you can also claim school fees, for example, potentially up to university if that can be agreed. And also, quite often we have clients that come in and they say to us, look, I'm mum, I've been bringing up the children, I haven't got any financial assets myself, my partner has got the bulk of the wealth. How on earth am I going to fund my legal fees? I want you to help me. And one of the other things that's available to unmarried families in this scenario is you can make a claim for costs. And what that means is that you can ask the court to make an order that the other partner pay your ongoing legal fees until such time as you get a financial settlement. So even if you are concerned about funding your legal fees in this type of case, you know, speak to a solicitor. You know, it may be that you can get that public fund, that legal assistance in place quite early. A fighting fund, absolutely. And Stuart, you touched on the CSA. Mm-hmm. What is the CSA? What does it stand for? How does this link to children cases?
Well, the CSA, the Child Support Agency, is the agency which deals with payments from non-resident parents to resident parents in respect of children. This goes for those couples who have been married and split up, and also unmarried couples. What will happen in terms of Schedule 1 claims is that the Schedule 1 claim is not meant to be a top-up of the CSA assessment. I'll qualify that later, but the purpose of Schedule 1 applications is not to go above what's been assessed by the CSA. What can instead happen is that the CSA does have a limit of an income which can be assessed and from which CSA payments can be made. That's at the moment, although this is subject to change, is £104,000 in income per year for the non-resident parent. If a non-resident parent earns in excess of that, Schedule 1 can then step in and make a maintenance claim for the income earned above that level.
Mm. And so what we're saying is that any income under £104,000 net per year of the non-resident parent, if a CSA assessment, the Schedule 1 can only bite if you have a client whose income is worth more than £104,000 a year. If the income is under that, then the court will not have any jurisdiction to order maintenance payments. It's only above that level of net income.
Yes, because the CSA will step in. That does change where the CSA cannot buy it. For example, where the non-resident parent is abroad, that's when Schedule 1 can step in and provide for maintenance payments going forward.
And Stuart, there are changes ahead to the Child Support Agency that are coming into force. Is that something that our viewers need to be aware of?
Yes, this will be touched on in further programmes, but it's being introduced gradually. Currently, it only impacts on families where there are four or more children. But the rules regarding CSA payments are changing. For example, the non-resident parents' gross income will be taken into account, not their net income. And the way in which the actual payments are calculated dependent on that income are changing. It's beyond the ambit of this show to go into that into any detail, but you should be aware if you are currently in a situation where where there are CSA payments and you do have four or more children, the rules have changed and they will continue to change gradually over the next year or so for families with three or less children.
Mm. One thing we would just say to our viewers is that if there is scope for the court to deal with maintenance, child maintenance, as opposed to the CSA, it may be that you could get more that way. But as we say, CSA, the court's ability to override the CSA can be quite limited. But again, you know, take legal advice. And I think really just to summarise what we're saying is that if you're unmarried and you own a property, yes, and you don't have any children together, potentially, you know, it may be difficult later on to make a claim. So look at it early when you're moving in together. Look at how you're going to buy a house. If you are unmarried and you own a property, but you have children together, then your claims are going to be much, much wider. So again, you know, take advice early on. So Stuart, that concludes our show for this evening. Thank you very much for joining us in the studio. I hope our viewers have found tonight's programme helpful. At the International Family Law Group, we're able to offer services in relation to all areas of family law, not just in relation to unmarried couples. But if there is anything in this programme that you have found of interest or that we can assist you with, both Stuart and I are available to help. Our website is www.iflg.uk.com. Please feel free to either have a look at our website or give us a call on 0203 178 5668 and we'll be more than happy to help. So until next week, thank you very much and Gali Nikdasas.